the power of human beings to affect and control and change the environment is growing as our technology grows. And at present time, we clearly have reached the stage where we are capable, both intentionally and inadvertently, to make significant changes in the global climate and in the global ecosystem. And we've probably been doing, on a smaller scale, things like that for a very long period of time. Because the effects occupy more than a human generation, there is a tendency to say that they are not our problem. Of course, then they are nobody's problem. Not on my tour of duty, not on my term of office. It's something for the next century. Let the next century worry about it. But the problem is that there are effects, and the greenhouse effect is one of them, which have long-time constants. If you don't worry about it now, it's too late later on. And so in this issue, as in so many other issues, we are passing on extremely grave problems for our children when the time to solve the problems, if they can be solved at all, is now. If you ask what determines the Earth's climate, clearly the main thing that determines it is sunlight. Sunlight is what heats the Earth. Not all the light that arrives at the Earth from the sun goes to heating the Earth. Some of it is reflected back. It's just the part that is absorbed. And what happens is there's a certain rate at which sunlight is absorbed by the Earth's surface, and there's a certain rate at which the Earth's surface radiates to space. If you add these infrared absorbing gases to a planetary, to a planet, then what happens is the sunlight comes in as before, but when the surface tries to radiate to space in the infrared, it is blocked. It is impeded by the absorbing gases. And so the surface temperature has to rise so that there is an equilibrium between what comes in and what goes out. So this is the greenhouse effect. It is a misnomer for more reasons than one. It's a misnomer in particular because that's not how the florist greenhouse works, but that's a very minor point. I'd like to stress that the greenhouse effect makes life on Earth possible. If there were not a greenhouse effect, the temperature would, as I say, be 30 centigrade degrees or so colder, and that's well below the freezing point of water everywhere on the planet. The oceans would be solid after a while. A little greenhouse effect is a good thing. But there is a delicate balance of these invisible gases, and too much or too little greenhouse effect can mean too high or too low a temperature. And here we are pouring enormous quantities of CO2 and these other gases into the atmosphere every year with hardly any concern about its long-term and global consequences. The significant temperature changes on the Earth between ice ages and out of ice ages, glacial and interglacial time periods, seems to be connected with quite small changes in the amount of sunlight that reaches the Earth due to changes in the Earth's orbital properties, and that is a suggestion that the Earth's climate system may be very delicately dependent on the sorts of factors that we're talking about here, and that's why it makes sense to study past climatic change on the Earth as an attempt to obtain some calibration. Another source of calibration is the other planets. Every planet with an atmosphere has some degree of a greenhouse effect. The most spectacular case by far is the greenhouse effect of Venus. It's the nearest planet. It's a planet about the same mass, radius, density as the Earth, but it is spectacularly different in several respects, one of which is that the surface temperature is about 470 degrees centigrade, 900 Fahrenheit, and that enormous temperature is not due to its being closer to the sun, because Venus is surrounded with bright clouds, and in fact, because it reflects so much light back to space, if that's all that was happening, it would be cooler, not warmer, than the Earth. The reason for this absurdly high temperature on the surface of Venus, which is well understood. I mean, Soviet spacecraft have landed on Venus and, in effect, stuck out a thermometer. There's no doubt that the surface temperature is very high, and later U.S. spacecraft have as well. The reason is a massive greenhouse effect in which carbon dioxide plays the major role. Now, the amount of CO2 in the Venus atmosphere is much larger than here. The atmosphere is almost entirely carbon dioxide, and there's 90 times more of it there than here. But it is an indication of what can happen in an extreme case. You look at Mars or Jupiter or Titan, the big moon of Saturn, and you have additional examples of greenhouse effects. Different gases, different amounts of sunlight reaching the surface, different planetary albedos and cloudiness. And in all those cases, there is also a greenhouse effect. In addition, it has been possible to calculate those greenhouse effects fairly accurately, so that the kind of theoretical armamentarium which is used to calculate the greenhouse effect changes on the Earth, is also used for other planets and therefore can be calibrated to some extent against those other planets. If we keep coming out with the right answer in all those different cases, then probably we understand fairly well how greenhouse effects work. So we have a kind of handwriting on the wall. Certainly there's more research to be done, but as I say, there is a consensus. What can be done about it? The idea that we should immediately stop burning fossil fuel has such severe economic consequences that no one, of course, will take it seriously. But there are many other things that can be done. I'd like to close by just saying a few words on the kind of perspective that this problem, as related problems, pose to us. Here is a problem which transcends our particular generation. It is an intergenerational problem. If we don't do the right thing now, there are very serious problems that our children and grandchildren will have to face. It is also a global problem. It is no good if just one or two major industrial nations take major steps to prevent a major increase still further in CO2 and other greenhouse gases, because other nations may, through their industrial development, cause the problem by themselves. So here is a sense in which the nations to deal with this problem have to make a change from their traditional concern about themselves and not about the planet and the species. A change from the traditional short-term objectives to longer-term objectives. And we have to bear in mind that in problems like this, the initial stages of global temperature increase, one region of the planet might benefit while another region of the planet suffers. And there has to be a kind of trading off of benefits and suffering. And that requires a degree of international amity which certainly doesn't exist today. I think that what is essential for this problem is a global consciousness, a view that transcends our exclusive identifications with the generational and political groupings into which by accident we have been born. The solution to these problems requires a perspective that embraces the planet and the future, because we are all in this greenhouse together.